Welcome to Your Personality Tree with Florence Littauer. Author of many helpful books, including Personality Plus, Florence is well known for her Christian counsel and her insights into what makes relationships work. In this program, you'll learn about the person God intended you to be and about how your personality interacts with others. Let's join Florence in Your Personality Tree.
A few years ago, Fred sent away to buy me a dozen pair of slightly irregular pantyhose. Now, Fred likes bargains, and it said on the brochure that these pantyhose had flaws that were barely perceptible to the human eye. Now, that's a tiny little flaw. So he sent away for these things, and it didn't cost much money. And when they arrived, every day I would take out a new pair, pull them out of the little package, hold them up, look at them, and each day I'd say to myself, those really look good. There's no flaws at all. Until I got to the 12th pair. When I got to the 12th pair, I remember reaching in that morning, taking out the little package, opening it up, and pulling out this 12th pair of pantyhose, slightly irregular pantyhose, with flaws barely perceptible to the human eye. Now, when you look at that, does that not have a flaw more than barely perceptible to the human eye? And I looked at that and I thought to myself, that thing has got to be more than slightly irregular. One little rear, one little leg. And yet I found that some of you have got some friends like this. Some of you ladies even married one of these. Somebody who was more than slightly irregular. I showed it to Lauren and I said, what should I do with this? And she said, send it back and get your money back. And I thought about it and I thought, yeah, I couldn't buy anything like this. I couldn't have anything made that would show how being slightly irregular is different in everybody's mind. That you are a little slightly irregular to me if you don't see things my way. And I might look a little slightly irregular to you if I didn't see things your way. Now, as I used this as a demonstration and held it up front and showed people my slightly irregular pantyhose, I had a lady come up to me and she said, I got some of those too. She says, I sent away for them. She says, I'm going to go home and get one for you. So she brought me her pair of slightly irregular pantyhose with flaws barely perceptible to the human eye. And this is her pair right here. Now, when you look at that, I mean, this thing is more than slightly irregular. For this lady to be regular, she would have to have a leg that came out one side, did a loop, and headed south. Another lady came up to me one day, and she said, I saw your pantyhose. She says, I have one I want to give you. Now, I want you to realize that I never did set out to make a collection of slightly irregular pantyhose, but people kept sending them to me. So this lady showed me this pair. Oh, you look at that. Now, this lady is more than slightly irregular. For her to even walk, she would have to limp a lot. The poor thing is uneven, unbalanced. So as I used this one, I got another one in the mail. I opened up the envelope one day, and when I looked at this pair, there was a note in there, and she said, I think this will add to your slightly irregular pantyhose. And it says right in the front here, petite. Is there anybody here that's petite? Who's little? Any petite people here? Are you petite? You look kind of petite. Come here for a minute. I'll just use you for a second. You don't have to be embarrassed. I mean, I'm not going to pay you for modeling, but I thought maybe if you just stand here for a minute, you look shorter than I am, aren't you? All right, I just want you to verify what that says on there for the size.
It is petite.
It does say petite, doesn't it? Now, she is shorter than I am, is that right? All right, these are petite pantyhose, slightly irregular. Well, look where they come, right up underneath your chin. Yeah, they won't fit you, will they? No, well, thank you for trying, thank you. When you look at these pantyhose, you realize that this poor lady is all stretched out. Now you may, some of you tonight may have some friends that are stretched out of shape, that are way bigger than they need to be, who started out when somebody married them as tiny little people, and now somehow they've gotten all stretched out of shape. I've found that many of you men tend to spend more time in buying a car than you do in choosing a wife. Many of you go down to the dealers, and if you wanted to buy a long, sleek black Cadillac, you would not dream of buying a chubby little red Volkswagen and taking it home and painting it and stretching it and banging it and trying to turn it into a long, sleek black Cadillac. And yet that's what many of you did with a wife. You took a look at her, and you decided that she was going to be all right once you made her over. Now, you see, if you went down to buy a car and you walked in, you would certainly check to make sure that the seat was stuffed correctly, that the steering wheel worked, and that the wheels were going around in the right direction. But some of you men bought a wife without that much thought. And you took her home and you checked out and you found her seat was overstuffed. That you couldn't steer her in any direction, and that her wheels were just going around in circles. Now, you see, if you want to have a wife that looks like what you aim for, then you have to be careful what you choose. Because some of you that wanted that long, sleek Cadillac are married to a chubby little red Volkswagen. And you've spent 20 years trying to make that little Volkswagen into a Cadillac, and it just hasn't worked. Now, some of you women, you may have started out hoping that you would get a charging cougar, and you've ended up with a powerless Pinto. So if that's what's happened to you, be grateful you've got anything in the garage and drive it carefully. Now, as I looked at these pantyhose, I thought, there's a lot of us that have problems in life and nobody else understands them. Here, this poor person stretched far out of shape from what she should have been in the beginning. This person right here, totally out of balance in life, off center in everything she does. This one right here, full of holes, hasn't quite got anything together. Nothing has gone correctly. She's in loops and holes, and this poor thing, only half there. Now, when we think about that, there's a lot of people like these, aren't there? And what we're doing in studying the personalities is beginning to understand that people are different, that each one of them has a certain kind of personality, and that when we understand that other person and know what their strengths are, we can praise them for their strengths, and we can learn to overlook their weaknesses. Because the only person that we can really change is ourselves, even though we have all these slightly irregular people that are around us, these people that don't see things our way. In the Bible, it tells me, let a man examine himself. Put yourself to the test. Judge yourself that you be not judged. Search me, O God. Know my ways. And if there be anything wrong with Fred, shape him up. Now that's the way I wish it said it. But unfortunately, when I looked, it said nowhere in the Bible that it was my job to make Fred spiritual. And yet when I was first a Christian, I felt that I was somewhat commissioned by God to be that junior Holy Spirit hovering over Fred, trying to shape him up. Now we've learned in our life that I can't work on anybody but me. So we're looking at this tonight as a tool. How can I look at myself to figure out what I can do with me so that I can amplify my strengths and prayerfully and humanly work to overcome my weaknesses? When we look at the different personalities, let's review. The sanguine person wants to have fun and they love to talk. The choleric person, they want to have control and they love to work. The choleric feels that if you can't win, you don't enter the contest at all. They must win. The melancholy person, they really want it perfect, and they love to sit and think. Now, isn't it interesting that the thinker marries the talker? The talker wants to talk all the time, while the thinker wants to sit quietly. It was very difficult for me to understand when I was first married to Fred that he liked silence. I couldn't imagine anyone could enjoy silence. I mean, what fun is there in silence? And the phlegmatic person is peaceful, and they like to rest. And isn't it interesting that the one who likes to rest usually marries the one who wants to work? And then they spend most of their time in clashing. Now, as we look at this today, we're going to see the strengths. We've already seen that there are strengths in each of us and weaknesses. We've seen that strengths carried to extremes sometimes turn into weaknesses. And we're going to look today at what we can do to understand those difficult people. How can we get along with them? Now, as we think about this, let's look at some of the strengths. The sanguine person loves to talk. They want to have a good time. They have a lot of fun with everybody. And they usually marry the melancholy, who does not want to have a lot of fun, who does not like people, and who doesn't even want to go to parties. Now, isn't that a shame? Before they get married, the melancholy goes everywhere with the sanguine. And they say to themselves, won't it be wonderful to be married to the sanguine? I won't have to laugh. I won't have to be with the people. I can just stay by myself and think, and she can do all the socializing. Doesn't that sound good? And then they get married and they find out that the sanguine does talk all the time, that they never stop talking. And this person wants to have a rest. So we tend to marry these people who are directly opposite from what we are. Now, one of the principles that we want to look at today is that when we think about these different personalities, we want to realize that it's important, if we wish to get along with those difficult people, that we realize that each one is different, and that our job is to keep that other person functioning in their strengths and not in their weaknesses. Now, we know if we were in business, and each one of you think of being in business, and perhaps in your business you need two things today. You need a person who's a typist, and you need a person who is an artist. So you put an ad in the paper, and what shows up? An artist and a typist, and they come for the jobs. And so you bring them in, and you test them out, and you find out, yes, the typist can type, yes, the artist is great. You bring them in, you give them the jobs, and you set them to work. But now what would happen if you said to the typist, I hired you as a typist, but I would now like to make you over and make you be an artist. So I'm going to have you stay away from the typewriter, and you come over here, you be an artist. And then you took the artist and said, I'm going to make you into a typist. Now if you did that, you wouldn't be too bright, would you? I mean, that doesn't make any sense at all. And yet that's what we do in marriage. We buy ourselves a typist, and we take that person home and try to change them into an artist. They have no ability at being an artist, and they end up pretty soon, they're functioning in their weaknesses instead of in their strength. We take the artist, we make them into a typist. There's no way that they can do that, because that's not their nature. And isn't it amazing that in marriage, what we do is we marry somebody who's totally opposite from what we are. We marry them because they have opposite strengths. It tells us in the Bible, the two of us shall become one. That I take my strengths and I fill in Fred's gaps. Fred takes his strengths, he fills in my gaps. And when we both function as we should, we become one. We marry opposite people because that's what we should. When you think about it, do your children need two of you? I mean, just think of that. Do they need two of you? See, one is enough. And so we need to marry people of opposite strengths so that we fill in each other's gaps. But what happens? Let's do an example. Let's say we have a sanguine woman here, and of all the marriage counseling I do, the problem group that I see the most frequently is the sanguine woman with the melancholy man. That's the one that I find the most. Let's say we have the sanguine woman. She has lots of fun, lots of charisma, lots of charm, and she goes around doing fun, wonderful things. So she marries the melancholy, who thinks she's just adorable. Melancholies know that they need a lifetime Valium pill. So they marry the sanguine, and they figure this will be cheaper than going on drugs or getting into psychiatry. So they marry this person to keep them happy. And then as soon as they get that person home, what do they try to do with her? You tell me, what do they try to do? They try to change them. They say, all right, I married her happy, now I will make her miserable. I will move her over here. I will turn her into something that she was not fit to be. I will take the typist and turn her into an artist. I will make her into something for which she has no qualifications and no ability, and I will beat her down until I get her over here on a chart, on a graph, doing everything my way. Now, you see, that's what we do in marriage. I find case after case after case, plus 15 years of Fred and me trying that. That I tried to make him to be happy like me, he tried to get me serious and on a chart like him. And we found out it never worked at all. But once we understood this, we could see that what I was to be was different from what Fred was to be. Now, I find many times, if we were counseling this marriage couple, and here she used to be happy, and she married him. One lady told me, she said, on the honeymoon, in the motel, I started to spray my hair, and she said, he screamed at me, stop! She says, I stopped right then. She says, I didn't know what I was doing wrong. She says, what am I doing? He said, don't ever spray your hair without putting towels on the carpeting first. He said, because if you do it this way, the residue from the hairspray is going to get into the carpets. She said, we don't even own this motel. He said, you've got to learn right from the beginning how to do everything perfectly. Now, you see, here was this poor lady. She got married happy, and on the honeymoon, he started to transform her. Now, after the years go by, and he's tried to move her from here over to here, he's tried to put her into a job for which she is totally unqualified, that she does not fit and does not understand and cannot do in any way at all. And after he's moved her over here, and she now is functioning melancholy, does that mean that she is melancholy? No, she's not melancholy. It's just that she's been made to act like one. So actually, she's a phony. She doesn't realize it. He doesn't realize it. So after a while, she's functioning melancholy. I know I had to do this. I had to do everything perfectly. I had to check off all the charts. Fred would go away for a business trip, and while he was gone, I'd say to the children, the ogre is gone. Fun, wonderful mother is here. We will now have a good week. You don't have to get up at the right time. I don't care when you go to bed. We don't have to check off any of the charts. Oh, what freedom. We didn't check charts for a whole week. And the night before Fred came home, do you know what we did the night before he came home? We put checks all over everything. Like we'd done it all week. You see, I was functioning melancholy. I wasn't a melancholy, but that's how I was functioning. So many women come to me with this problem, and then they'll say to me, they'll say, one day he came home, and he looked at me. Now, what did he say to her? You aren't the same woman I married. Isn't that a revealing thought? Why is she not the same woman he married? Because what has he done? He's tried to take the chubby little red Volkswagen and try to turn her into a long, sleek Cadillac. He's tried to make her over. He's no longer happy with the strengths that she has. He's got her over here functioning in the totally wrong thing. She's been doing this now for 15 years, just mechanically working through life, miserable all the time. And now he looks at her and says, you aren't the woman I married. Then worse than that, as he says, you aren't any fun anymore. But then he finishes it by saying, but I have what? Found someone who is. Isn't that a shame? What does that mean he's about to do? He's now going to go out, and he's found himself another sanguine. And he's going to take that little thing home, and what's he going to do with her? As soon as he gets her home, he's going to move her right over to here. Spend time doing that. One night I shared this with a group of doctors. I was speaking at a doctor's conference, and at the end, one of the doctors came up to me, and he said to me, I really appreciated what you said about trying to make these people over. He said, I didn't know what it was I was doing, but I want to tell you that I am just divorcing my fourth sanguine. Now see, here's a man who made the same mistake over and over again. He was trying to marry a perfect person. He wanted to marry somebody who was fun, but as soon as he got that one home, he wanted to turn them into something different. How important it is for us in life to realize that God made us all different. That we are not the same. We all in this room tonight, we have different fingerprints, we have different looks about us. There are no two of us that look alike. And yet we spend most of our time trying to get that other person to come over here and be like me. If we could understand those different people, if we could realize what made them tick and why they weren't like us, we could get along with just about anybody. Because you see, you can get along with a sanguine as long as you let them have fun. You can get along with a choleric as long as you let them be in charge. You can get along with a melancholy as long as you let them do everything right and try to do the best you can with them. You can easily get on with a phlegmatic. They're the all-purpose person. They don't give you any trouble at all. They won't buck you in any way, and they'll follow whatever you say. So we can get along with just about anybody. Sometimes I have people say to me, which one of these people should I marry so that I could be happy? I tell them, if you want to be happy, don't marry any of these people. Because when you marry these people to be happy, you'll never be happy. Because we don't get married in order that me, miserable little lady, is going to marry this miserable little man. And somehow, because the two of us get married one day, we're going to turn happy. It doesn't work that way. If we can't examine ourselves and figure out our own strengths and weaknesses, there's not much chance that we're going to get along well with anybody else. Let's run this through in the area of pastors. Let's look at our pastor. Now, all of you have a pastor. I don't know your pastors, but let's look at this so that we can begin to use this tool, because this is what it is. It's a tool. It's just a help to show you how to understand those other people. Let's look at it from this point of view. We now have little Pastor Popular. Pastor Popular just started a Bible study one day. He loved studying the Bible. He had such a gift, such a language that he could just pour out words on everybody. He was talking away happily all the time. People loved to come. He had such charisma, such charm, such magnetism that people came from far and wide to his Bible studies. And after a while, the Bible study got to be 200 people, and they said, why don't we start a church? That sounded good. So Pastor Popular started a church. People came every Sunday just to hear him because he was so much fun, had such funny stories to tell. They always had happy endings, everything was enjoyable, and people loved to come to that church. So after a while, when Pastor Popular got going, and the church was up now to 500 people, and people began to ask, where is the money? What has happened to it? And they found out that Pastor Popular didn't know what had happened to the money. He'd kept it in a shoebox, and he didn't even know where the shoebox was. He didn't know what to do about the money, and then people began to say, Pastor Popular was all right when he was just teaching a Bible study. But now that we're a church, don't you think we should get somebody deeper? Somebody who's deep in the Word? I frequently have people tell me, I want depth. Usually these poor people haven't gotten out of the shallows themselves, but they're looking for depth. So they said, let's get another pastor. We need to get rid of Pastor Sanguine, and we need a man with depth. Fred had talked with one pastor one day who had just been turned out of the church that he had started. And he said, it was my church. I started it. I was the fun up front. Everybody loved me. And they let me go, and they did not even give me a farewell party. Now, that's sad for a sanguine, isn't it? Not only to be sent away, but no party when you're going. Now, after we get rid of Pastor Popular, then what we do is we get Pastor Perfect. We want Pastor Perfect because we want someone who is deep. We want someone who understands God's word thoroughly. We want a man who's on his knees day after day praying for all the saints in the fold and 5 minutes for those who haven't joined yet. And we want this man to be deep in the word. We want a man who knows Greek. And in fact, I had one lady tell me, she said, we're looking for a new pastor. But she said, we're trying to find a man who has never studied Greek and has never taken a tour to the Holy Land. Now, sometimes that's what we're looking for. But Pastor Perfect has done it all. He's led all the tours. He's studied all the things. He's done everything he should do. He's a great prayer warrior. Oh, he's a man of brilliance and depth. So he comes in now, and all the group that used to love Pastor Sanguine, they say to themselves, oh, so glad he's gone. We now have a man with depth. So he announces from the pulpit, we are going to now bring every Sunday morning a Bible, a concordance, and a Greek interlinear translation. Would you bring notebooks, several kinds of pens, rulers, staplers, and perhaps some scotch tape? And we are going to get into this thing. This is going to become a college course. I have examined some of you, and I have found that most of you have never gotten beyond the milk stage. We are now going to get into the meat of the word. So come and be prepared. So Sunday morning comes, and the people that used to get up all happy to go see Pastor Popular, they used to be so thrilled to see him. Now they come with all their books in their hands, and they're coming staggering into church carrying all this material. Well, they get into this, and they study, and he's deep. And then after a while, they start talking in the parking lot, and they say out there, they say, isn't this a little too deep? I mean, did we really want to get into this thing that much? Do we care that much about the word? And they say, a lot of people have left. Remember how many people used to come to hear Pastor Popular? We've now got Pastor Perfect. The attendance has dropped off. Nothing seems to be moving. And all that's left is a few deep intellectual giants sitting there quietly every Sunday morning. Don't you think we need to get a man who'll get this thing moving again? Let's get a man who'll really go. Let's get someone who's got some ideas who'll challenge forth. So they say goodbye to Pastor Perfect, and they bring in Pastor Powerful. Now, Pastor Powerful knows how to run a church. He's run many of them into the ground, and he knows how to do this. And he is going to take over with strength. He gets all of the people going, and they want him to come in, and they want him to build up the congregation again. So right off, every Pastor Powerful I've known walks in the first day with blueprints. They come in with blueprints. We're going to add things onto the church. We're going to build a new tower. We're going to have bells up there. We're going to have a big atrium out here with fountains. We're going to build a wing over here for the Sunday school, a few for the elderly. We're going to get all new buildings. We're going to get this thing moving. We're going to start fund drives. Going to pass out envelopes to you all the very first day. Want you to give until it hurts. Because to make this church get going, we're going to have to earn a lot of money. We're going to have to go into debt, so I need all of you to dig deeply so that we can get this thing moving again. So they all begin to move, and everybody gets to action. Every Saturday is a work day at the church. There's no way you can be home raking your own leaves. You've got to go and paint the church. So everybody's moving. Everything is going. And it gets bigger. And they build wings. I've been in some churches, had so many wings, they're about to flow away. So as he gets all this thing going, and everything's exciting, and everybody's exhausted and all worn out, and after a while, we find out that he meets another powerful person, perhaps the chairman of the board of elders, and they have some disagreements. And then pretty soon we find out there's rumors of a split in this church. I've been to a lot of churches where they say, we have just gone through a doctrinal split. Now, I've never known a church who really went through a doctrinal split, because most of them in the congregation don't know enough doctrine to split over it. They are not having a doctrinal split. They are having a personality problem. And pretty soon, Pastor Powerful sees things are not going his way, and if it doesn't go his way, it's no good. He packs up half the congregation, walks down the street, and starts a new church. Now we're without a pastor. So what do we decide we need now? We remember how much fun it was with Pastor Popular. Remember how deep we were when we had Pastor Perfect. And now the whole church is split because Pastor Powerful has taken all the people away and left us with just this little pitiful handful. And now what do we need to do? We need to have a healing time. We need to get a pastor who will just come in and keep peace. who will pull this all together, who will put band-aids all over our wounded spirits, who will bring us all together in harmony and peace. And we bring him in, and we say, oh, great, now we've got Pastor Peaceful. Isn't this going to be wonderful? Pastor Peaceful right off says we're going to cut the size of the ceremony down on Sunday mornings. We don't need to stay here for an hour and 15 minutes. 28 minutes, we'll do it. We can do everything we need to do in a very short time. Have brief prayers, just a couple of songs. I'll give you a brief message, send you home in time for the football games. No problems any longer. We are going to have an easy, relaxed church. So everybody gets kind of relaxed, and they sit back, they lean back, and they say, oh, it's so good. We don't have to work anymore. We can just take it easy. So they take it easy on Sunday morning, week after week, month after month. After a while, they begin to say, this is so boring. This is so dull. What is going on in this church? Nothing is happening. And then they say, do you remember how much fun it used to be with Pastor Popular? And then they decide, let's get rid of Pastor Peaceful, and we'll get back a new Pastor Popular. Now, you see, this is what happens in so many churches. And as I visit from 3 to 5 churches a week, and I see all these various pastors, that I know even before I get there what they're going to be. Because the melancholy, perfect pastor has sent me all the instructions in triplicate. I've received those ahead of time, so I know who he is going to be. Pastor Powerful is the one that tells me exactly what I'm going to do, how long I'm going to speak, where I'm going to stand. He gives me all the instructions the minute I walk in the church. The popular pastor is the one that gets up and gives me a half-hour introduction, lets me speak for 10 minutes, and then spends the next half-hour summarizing what it was I just said. He wants to talk more than he wants me to talk. And then Pastor Peaceful, we've found, goes away for the weekend. He feels we've got her here. She can take charge of the whole thing by herself. Now, when we look at these differences, even their hymns are different. The popular pastor, his hymn is, Jesus wants me for a sunbeam. Pastor Powerful sings, onward Christian soldiers marching as to war. Pastor Melancholy says, I was sinking deep in sin. And Pastor Phlegmatic says, leaning on the everlasting arms. Now, as we look at these, realize that the only person that had all of the strengths and none of the weaknesses was the Lord Jesus. Because Jesus had the charisma, charm, storytelling ability of the sanguine. He could hold people on a hot, dusty hillside for an entire afternoon and tell them stories, and they loved every minute of it, and there wasn't even a McDonald's. We found out that Jesus had the power and the ability to take 12 men that had no training at all, had never gone to seminary, put them all together, have them march off in the same direction, and have them evangelize the entire world. What power he had. He also had the depth of the melancholy, of the person who was perfect, because he could look into that woman's eyes at the well and say to her, go get your husband. She said, I don't have a husband. He said, I know you don't. You don't have a husband, and you weren't even married to the last man that you lived with. And she went back to her people, and she said, I don't know this man, but he sure knows me. He looked into my eyes, and he knew me. He had the perception, the perfection of the melancholy. And he also was the Prince of Peace. And he said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they are called the sons of God. Only Jesus had all of the strengths and none of the weaknesses. We can't be just like him, but our aim is to become like him. So why don't you start trying today? So often in magazines, I read articles that say, if only we could meet each other's emotional needs, that we wouldn't have any problems. People wouldn't be out looking for other partners if we knew how to meet that other person's needs. And yet so often we don't know how to do that. We don't know what it is that other person needs. Fred and I have found out in our life that even in giving presents, we tend to give the other person what it is we want. Fred loves perfume and cologne. We say that he has a ministry with cosmetic sales girls. Whenever I'm shopping, Fred is standing around talking to the cosmetic sales girls, and they give him samples. He has an entire collection of little bottles of men's cologne. Now, it's interesting because it's a very good, phlegmatic, melancholy kind of gift because it doesn't cost a thing. He gets it from the girls free. He's excited about that, so he has this little collection of cologne. Now, the interesting thing is that I can't even smell cologne. It doesn't even interest me, and I don't even need any. But Fred gives me cologne. Now, why is it that he gives me cologne? What's he doing? He's giving me what? What he wants to receive. And that's the way we do with gifts. It's also the way we do with it filling each other's emotional needs. We tend to give that other person what it is that we want back. And we wonder why in the world, when we're giving it to them, they don't notice it and give it back to us. But you see, each one of us has different emotional needs. And as we look at this, we're going to see today, according to the personalities, what are our emotional needs? Let's look at the sanguine person first. They're the popular one, the one that wants to have fun. What are their emotional needs? Now, when we talk about emotional needs, we're not talking about something that it would be nice to have, like a big house, big cars. Oh, we all would like to have that. I'm talking about emotional needs. What do I need inside of me, given to me, in order that I can function as a normal person? What do I need? When we start with the sanguine, the first thing the sanguine needs is attention. They want to have attention. Now, those of you that are melancholy, you'd think, why should we be giving them attention? All they do is talk all the time. They don't say anything of consequence. Why should I pay attention? It depends on whether you want to get along with them. It depends on whether you want to meet their emotional needs in such a way that you will have a positive marriage or a positive relationship. So the sanguine person needs attention. I can remember my little daughter, Marita, when she was just a tiny child, very sanguine, and all the time she wanted me to pay attention to her. She would follow me around, she'd give me book reviews. She would read Cat in the Hat, and she'd spend an hour giving me a book review on it. I could have read the book in less time. And Marita was always following me around, talking to me. And one day it came to me, I wonder how long it would take for me to hear this book review if I sat down and listened to it. I sat down eye to eye with her, and as I did, she said to me, "Are you going to listen to me?" Now the fact that she said that showed me that she never thought I listened to her at all. So I said, "Yes, tell me the story." She told it in just a few minutes. And I found out from that Marita didn't need to give me book reviews. All Marita wanted was my attention. How interesting it is when we start giving somebody what they need, how different it looks from our point of view. They want to have attention. They also want to have approval. Sanguines must have people telling them they're wonderful. If you're raising a child and he's sanguine, and you say, go in and make your bed, and then you go in and look at it, and it's full of bumps, and you point that out. This bed is terrible. It's got bumps all over the place. And incidentally, melancholies give compliments like this. They don't give many. But when they give compliments, it's like this. That bed looks very good. And then what's the next word? But. So you all know. But the next time that you make your bed, you do it differently. Now, what does a little sanguine child hear when you say, the next time you do it this way? They decide, if I didn't get approval on the first time I did it, I'm just not going to do that anymore. So they won't do it. The sanguine is the only child that never grows by discipline and by negatives. They only grow by approval. So we need to remember that. A sanguine needs to be approved of. They want you to say, oh, you're adorable. Oh, you're so cute. You're so precious. You're so wonderful. You're adorable. That's what they want to hear. So they want attention and they want approval. The third thing they need is they want acceptance. They want to be accepted exactly as they are. Now, isn't that the way all of us would like to be? But a sanguine has to have it. If they're not accepted the way they are, they will be not functioning at their full strength. They will be like the typist who's going to be trying to be an artist. They won't function in the way they should. So we need to pay attention, we need to give approval, and we need to accept them as they are. Now let's assume we have a sanguine married to a melancholy, because that's usually what happens. And the melancholy, how apt is the melancholy to pay a lot of attention to what they consider the idle chatter of the sanguine? Not much possibility at all. How much do they want to approve of them? When is it that the melancholy will approve of anybody? When they what? Get perfect. What chance is there that the sanguine's going to get perfect? Absolutely no chance at all. So those of you who are melancholy, I know that'll depress you for a moment to realize that. But this sanguine is never going to get perfect. So you might start right today by accepting the fact that the sanguine is not going to get perfect. Now, what is it that the melancholy wants? They're married to each other. The sanguine wants attention. They want approval. They want acceptance, just as they are. The melancholy has already let them know, I will accept you someday when you get perfect. When you get straightened out. When you get on the chart. When you check everything off perfectly. Then I will like you. I can remember one day saying to Marita, do you know that Mother loves you? Now, I knew I loved her because she was always cute and adorable and fun, and I knew I loved her. So I said to her, do you know Mother loves you? She looked at me and she thought for a while. She said, well, I guess you would love me if I got good marks. I looked at her, I said, I never said that to you. She said, that's right, you never said it to me, but you sure looked it. I realized that while I never said that to Marita, I had given her the feeling that she was not acceptable until she got good marks. And I said to her, what did I do that showed you that? She said, well, she said, when Lauren's report card comes home, you tell everybody how great it is, you hang it on the refrigerator door. But when you look at my report card, you just look down there and you say, oh, and put it away. Now, you see, I found out that I had really never approved of Marita as she was. I'd never accepted her exactly as she was. So we don't tend to give the people what it is they're looking for. What is it the melancholy's looking for? Do they want the same things? Are they dying for attention, for approval? Are they dying to be accepted as they are? No, all they want is somebody that has a sensitive spirit. Somebody who's deep, somebody who gets in, somebody who understands them, somebody who cares. And that's what they want. Now, when we look at that, what chance is there the sanguine is going to get deep and get way inside of anything? Not much chance at all. Because you see, what the sanguine wants is superficial. They want something that's on the surface. They want it to come from somebody else. And down here, the melancholy wants something that's deep. They want you to get in there and they want you to think about it. I can remember when Fred and I were first believing Christians, and we attended a church where the pastor's wife was named Ruth Frost. Now, Ruth had an excellent voice, and she sang a lot of times in our church. Fred sang duets with her. Now, we had just become Christians. We had just started attending this church. And one day, a man came up to Fred, and he said to him, I would like you to sing at the governor's prayer breakfast. Now, Fred, being melancholy, being deep, and having what we call that subtle humility, which is that, oh, I'm really no good. And then what does that make the rest of us do? We have to then say, oh, you are really good. Say, oh, my hair looks terrible today. Oh, no, your hair looks lovely. You say, well, your hair looks good today. And they say, what was wrong with it yesterday? Very difficult to get these compliments across. So they asked Fred, would you sing at the governor's prayer breakfast? And Fred said to the man very humbly, he said, why don't you get somebody who can really sing? Now the man said, oh, Fred, we do want you. So Fred came home to tell me that story. Now, I had not really gotten very transformed by the Lord at that time, and I still thought everything I said was kind of cute if I threw it off right. So Fred walked in, and he said, they've asked me to sing at the governor's prayer breakfast. And I said to them, why don't you find somebody who can really sing? Now, if I had been a good, dutiful wife, what would I have said? Oh, you can sing, Fred. You're wonderful. You're the one. They chose the right person. Now, that's what I should have said. Had I understood his needs, had I known how to meet what he needed emotionally, that's what I would have said. But what did I say? He said, they asked me to sing. And I said, why don't you choose someone who can really sing? I said, that's right, Fred. Why didn't they choose Ruth Frost? Now, that did not go over well with Fred. In fact, it put Fred into a depression. He was depressed for 3 weeks. He didn't even speak to me for 3 weeks. Now, of course, it was 3 days before I realized he wasn't speaking to me. Once I found out that Fred was mad at me and that he was depressed, then I did the normal thing that those of us who are sanguines or cholerics do, and that is I said to him, what's the matter with you, Fred? Now, this is what happens to those of us of stronger natures. We stand at the edge of the hole and see our poor mate down there in the pit, sniveling. And we look down and we say, what is the matter with you, Fred? Now, what's their answer always? Nothing. See, that's, I always say nothing. Now, for you truthful melancholies, is that the truth? Is that the truth? Is it nothing? No, it's not nothing. It's terrible. It's really something. You are depressed. And so we say to you, what's the matter with you? And you say, nothing. And then we look at you and say, there is something wrong with you, Fred. What is it? What's the matter with you? Cheer up. Don't you see how happy I am? Why don't you be happy like me? Cheer up, Fred. What's the matter? I ask him again. He says, nothing, nothing, nothing. Now you see, you melancholies lie. You sound so pious and so good and serious, but you lie. Because we ask you what's wrong and you say nothing. We say, what's wrong? Nothing. What's wrong? Nothing. Now, after a while, how long do we want to stand around here looking down into this sorry pit, asking what's wrong with them? Not very long. So within a matter of hours, we take off to find friends who are pleasant. And we leave you down in the pit. So here's Fred now. He's down there in the pit. He's been down there for 3 weeks, all depressed. So finally, since I'm out flitting around having a good time with pleasant people, finally Fred decides he had better come up out of the pit. So Fred begins to come up, and then I look at him and I see he's getting a little bit relieved, and I say to him, what is the matter with you, Fred? And then he says to me, it's because you said, why don't they choose Ruth Frost? Now what do I remember 3 weeks later about Ruth Frost? I don't remember anything, but I can hardly remember who Ruth Frost is. Certainly, I don't remember what I said 3 weeks ago. And yet so many of you melancholies are sitting down in the pits waiting for those of us here to catch on to what it is we did wrong to you, and we've forgotten we ever said it. We don't know what we're doing, and you're sitting there waiting, and you're saying, if only they'd get inside me, if only they'd see how I felt. I won't give them any hints. I want to make life miserable for them. They've got to learn to get in there and find out. And we're up here saying, if we have to go that deeply, we don't want to know. Now, you see, there's a big difference in each one of us. So here, this person is dying for attention and approval and acceptance just as they are, and this one's down here sensitive, waiting for us to get inside and pull it out. To live with a melancholy, it's like having 20 questions for everything you do. You have to ask and ask and ask to pull it out. Now, the melancholy also, not only do they want you to be sensitive, but they want you to give them a little space. They want to have some space around them. They want to not have you all over them. Now, since the sanguine wants to have attention and the melancholy does not give it to them, what does the sanguine then do when they see that the melancholy is not paying attention to them? They come on stronger. Now they try to almost tackle you. Look at me. Here I am. Aren't I wonderful? Tell me something good. See me? See me? And we're screaming. And the more that the sanguine is screaming for attention, what's the melancholy do? They back up. They retreat. They say, oh boy, I don't want anything to do with her. And they pull away. So pretty soon we find we have this big gulf between us in marriage. Me sitting up here waiting for someone to pay attention, waiting to give me approval, waiting to accept me as I am, and Fred's putting me on eternal programs of training, and I never think I'm going to get along. And down here, Fred is sitting wistful at the bottom of the pit, waiting for me to get sensitive and get in there and pull it out and find out what's wrong. You see, we're nothing alike. And Fred wants to be separated. He doesn't want to have me crawling all over him. And another thing that the melancholy needs is a sense of order. They want to know from the rest of us that we know what day of the week it is. When I met Fred, I was so impressed that he had a watch and knew how to tell time. I thought, this is great. He can tell me where I'm going, what I'm doing. Now, you see, initially, Fred and I had problems with this because he didn't know what my needs were and I didn't know what his needs were. Now, as we've found these out, and as I've found out that Fred wants me to be sensitive, I don't come on so strong, I don't try to be so cute, that as I've found out that he wants a little space, I don't try to make him listen to me all the time, as I've found out that he wants a sense of order, I've learned how to keep a calendar, I've learned to know what place I'm in and where I'm going and what day it is, and I've worked on this, because Fred and I found out that we didn't have any idea how to meet each other's emotional needs. Why do we run off and find other people? Because nobody's meeting our needs, and we're trying to find somebody who does. Now that we have this figured out, and Fred gives me attention, gives me approval on everything that I do every single day, and as I have become sensitive to some of his needs, as we've done this, we've worked out that now, instead of being two people very opposite, we still have our own personalities. I haven't changed and become melancholy. Fred has not become sanguine, but we've learned to adjust to each other. In fact, a little while ago, Fred sent me on a trip, gave me my ticket, and when I was sitting in my motel room at night, I looked at my ticket. Now, Fred does all of the planning, because you see, what we've done is we've learned to put each other in the places where we're strong, so that Fred functions where he's good. He keeps the charts and the lists and the graphs and makes the tickets and plans all my itinerary. And then he lets me stand up here and talk, and that's what I want to do. So we've worked out so that we're working now in our strengths instead of functioning out of our weaknesses. So this one day, I looked at my ticket, and it said that I was going from Chicago to El Paso. Now, to get from Chicago to El Paso, those are cities you all know about, that to go from Chicago to El Paso, this was my itinerary. Chicago, and then Dallas, and then Austin, and then Dallas, and then El Paso. Now, I'm not much for understanding these itineraries, but I didn't think that sounded like it made much sense. I thought, why am I going jogging down to Austin? So I called Fred up, and he said, well, you are Advantage Gold on American Airlines. And they have a prize coming up. And you have to have a certain number of miles and a certain number of trips by tomorrow night at midnight. And he said, when I counted it all up, now you see, he keeps all these charts. If I had to keep these charts, would I even know where the charts were if I kept them? But Fred knows. He's got all the charts. I'm Advantage Gold, and I'm Platinum on something else. I'm Silver over there, and I'm all kinds of things. I sound all wonderful when you look at all these things on paper. Fred keeps them all down perfectly. If they miss miles, he calls them up, and then they give them back to him. And we always get the miles. So when I was talking with him that night, I asked him about it, and I said, why am I going down that little jog to Austin? He said, well, you're two legs short on the spring special. Got two legs short on the spring special. So I came down here, I did what he said. I flew down to Austin, I got here, I called up Evelyn from the airport. And I said, guess what, Evelyn? I'm at the Austin airport. And she said to me, I'll be right there to get you. I said, don't bother. By the time you get here, I'll be gone. She said, well, how come? What are you doing there? And I said, well, I just took a little jog down here. I'm going right back to Dallas because I was two legs short on the spring special. Now, I left the phone booth, and I went out there, and as I went out to go towards the gate, I noticed a group of men. Now, these were the same men I'd seen coming down on the plane with me. So I looked at these men. 8 or 10 men were standing there, more or less sanguine, 8 or 10. And I looked over there, and I saw these men, and I went over to them, and I said, didn't you just come down on the plane from Dallas? And they said, yes. And I said, are you going back to Dallas? They said, yes. I said, why is that? They all smiled, and they said in unison. They said, we're two legs short on the spring special. Now, see, I wasn't the only one that had that particular mission that night. Now, as we have learned to understand each other, Fred plans it all and does what he does well. I do what I do well. And because we both have a lot of choleric, that's the powerful in us, the one that wants to run everything, that wants to be in charge, what we've had to do is to draw a line right across the middle. Fred takes care of the office and all the schedules, and I don't second guess him. I take care of what's up front, doing my part of it, and he doesn't try to second guess me. Now, he does, of course, evaluate me quite a bit and give me little report cards. But other than that, he pretty much leaves me to doing what I do. Now, as we look at this, what does the choleric need? What are the emotional needs of the choleric? Now, when we look emotionally, the sanguine has childlike emotions. They never quite grow up. The melancholy has deep emotions. So we find out we've got someone here that's like a child, wide-eyed childlike until they die, and we've got this person down here who's very deep and mature. And they're married to each other. Can you see those problems? Now, we have the choleric, who's usually married to the phlegmatic, and the choleric person is the one who is strong and powerful and in control. And they have undeveloped emotions. They never have emotions. Why not? What does a choleric feel about emotions? They feel that emotions are weak. Cholerics don't want to be weak. So they won't have any emotions. They don't develop them. They hide them. They say, no, I'm not going to be emotional. I will not cry. Choleric fathers tell little boys, don't you dare cry. That's not a man. You cannot cry. You be brave. And so they grow up undeveloped emotions. And they usually marry the phlegmatic, peaceful person who has hidden emotions. I can remember my mother saying to me, I pride myself on the fact that no one ever really knows what I'm thinking about. And isn't that true? So here we have hidden emotions married to undeveloped emotions. And we have here childlike emotions married to deep and mature kind of emotions. In no way, by accident, are we going to meet each other's needs. Now, the choleric's needs are simple. They just want you to do what they say when they tell you to do it. Very simple needs. If you do that, they will be happy. They love obedience. The other thing that they want is a lot of credit for all the good works they've done. Because you realize that the choleric self-worth is in how much work they do every day. The sanguine's worth is on how everybody loves them. If enough people love them, they're happy. And if they get credit for enough work, they're happy. So they, both of them are looking for external areas in which to get their emotional needs met. This one needs compliments. This one needs praise and credit for all the work they do. This is the person who does the work, the one who's always handling everything. Every church I go into is some choleric woman who has a big ring of keys. The pastor can't even get into a file drawer without finding this choleric woman who will let him in there. She's in control of everything. So the choleric loves to be powerful. They find themselves in situations where they can be in charge of everybody else. But what they want you to do, and if you want to get along with them, all you have to do is tell them every day, I don't know how in the world you do all that you do. I don't know how you accomplish that much. It is amazing what you can get done in a given day, and the choleric will blossom and be thrilled. You may have a choleric boss. Instead of going home and complaining about him, go in the next day and say, I am amazed at how much you do. Am I impressed with what you get done in a given day? Nobody can work like you. Oh, does the choleric love to hear that. Sanguine wants to have him say, oh, you're so cute and adorable and fun. Oh, you have such a sense of humor. This one wants praise for all the work they've done. This one wants you to get inside and be sensitive. And the phlegmatic wants a sense of worth. They want some value. They want to feel way inside that they're worth something. Most of them don't feel that they are because of the fact that all through life they've had sanguines talking over them. They've had cholerics pushing them around, telling them where to go. They've had melancholies thinking deeply, and they're just sitting there saying, my, what good am I? And they need a feeling of worth. Now, when we look at these just briefly today, realizing the differences in our needs, we can see that left to the law of averages, we would never guess how to meet other people's needs. But with these simple little tools, we can learn how to compliment, give approval and attention and acceptance to the sanguine. We can learn how to give praise and credit to the choleric and to appear, at least, obedient. We can find out how to get sensitive with the melancholy, how to meet their needs by giving them a little space and by having a sense of order. We can help the phlegmatic by giving them a feeling of worth, that they are worth something. Now, as we look at this, many of us go through life never having anybody meet our emotional needs. Let me share with you a story about my mother. A few years ago, she was in a convalescent home, and I went over there to visit her one day. Now, my mother is phlegmatic. Phlegmatics don't give enthusiastic praise on their own. They don't tell you what great work you've done, which is what you want. So I went to visit my mother that day, and it seemed that everything I told her, all she said was, uh-huh, that's nice. And I remember coming home and saying to Fred, when is my mother ever going to appreciate and understand all the things I've done? Now, the minute I said it, I realized it was somewhat of a conceited question. It was only a few years ago, and Fred said to me, how many times has your mother gotten enthused over what you do before? I said, well, she's never gotten enthused over me. I can remember one day when she looked at my schedule and she said, it's amazing, you're so busy, when what you do is something nobody needs. Kind of looked at that and thought. She went to visit my brother, who was the toast of Dallas, the best-known radio personality in Dallas, chosen by Billboard this past year as the outstanding radio personality in the entire country. My mother went and saw him do one of his programs. And after she finished watching the program, she came to me and she said, do you think that Ron will ever grow up and get a real job? Now, you see, mother somehow missed it. She missed all these things with us. And this frustrated me. I thought, why doesn't my mother understand what I'm doing? Why doesn't she see what it is? Why doesn't she see that there are people whose lives get changed because of what I'm doing and what the Lord can do through me? She never saw any of that at all. So that day I came home and I said to Fred, what's it going to take to get my mother enthused? And when he asked me, how many times has she been enthused before? And I said, never. He said, then why do you think in her dying years at 85, that she's going to suddenly get enthused over you? Now that was so down to earth that it hurt me. I thought, why did he say that? And then he looked at me and he said, Florence, when are you going to grow up and stop trying to get out of your mother something she can't give you and start giving her what she needs? Now that was the day that I began to look and figure out, what have I done wrong? I've spent my whole life as the little girl. No matter how old I got, I was still that little girl. And what was I looking for? I was looking for my mother to meet my needs. I was looking for my mother to say, Florence, you're adorable and cute and wonderful, and I think you've done a great job in life, and I'm so proud of you. I was waiting for her approval. I was waiting for her to tell me that the works I did were worthwhile, and my mother never, ever told me any of those things. So Fred said, grow up, Florence. Stop trying to get out of your mother something she can't give you, and start giving her what she needs. The next time I went to visit my mother, I prayed on the way over and I said, Lord, what's my mother need? For sanguine cholerics, needs are physical things, things like a coffee table, a new refrigerator. I pointed out to the Lord all the things I'd given my mother. I thought maybe he'd miss some of them. So I told him all the things. I went right down the list and I said, Lord, I've given her this, I've given her this, I've given her this. What does she want? And I was waiting for the Lord to tell me, to give me a great vision and tell me, this is what your mother needs. She needs a new dress, new nightgown. I thought the Lord would tell me something. I wanted to go buy something and hand it to my mother and say, here, mother, now I've met your needs. But on the way over, nothing came to me. And as I drove along, all that came to me was, ask your mother how she likes it there. Now, those of you that have had to put your mother in any kind of a convalescent home, you know you don't want to ask her how she likes it there. I didn't want to ask her that. But that's all that came to me. And I kept praying, Lord, that's not what I ask her. Please tell me, what should I give my mother? He said, ask her how she likes it there. I went down, I sat with her that day, sat in her room. I stopped trying to impress her with all my great works. I didn't try to be funny, as I thought was my job to do in a convalescent home. Wasn't that what God sent me there for, to be amusing to all the people? I didn't try to be funny that day. I didn't try to look for credit. I just sat there and nothing much happened. After a while, it kept coming to me, ask her how she likes it there. And I remember how brave it was for me to open my mouth and say, Mother, tell me, how do you like it here? My mother looked at me. She gave me a little phlegmatic smile. She looked up and she said, this is the nicest place I've ever lived. I looked at her dumbfounded. I wouldn't have wanted to live there. Gloomy place, old people dying. So I didn't want to live there. I looked at her and I said, what do you mean this is the nicest place you've ever lived? She said, well, the very first day when I came here, they took me down to the dining room. They assigned me to my seat. And she said, do you know what they did? They gave me the only chair at the head of the table. And it was the only one that had arms on it. And then she just smiled at me. And I looked at her and suddenly I realized that all my life I'd been giving my mother clothes. I'd been giving her things. I'd been waiting for her to appreciate the good works I'd done for her and how sweet and wonderful I was as a daughter. She'd never appreciated any of those things at all, because all my mother had been waiting for was someone who gave her enough respect and worth to put her at the head of the table and give her a chair with arms on it. The next time I was home, I had my mother over, and I realized when I was getting dinner ready that night that I had never put my mother at the head of any table. I had always put her down the side with dull people. I'd always put her with that obnoxious person that talked too much that nobody liked. Because, you see, mother fit in anywhere. She never complained. I could put her on a siding, and it never mattered to her at all. So I'd never put her at the head of the table. But that night I did. I even cooked what she liked, a New England boiled dinner, because my mother's way of cooking was to throw everything into a pot of water and boil it until there was no flavor left. I did that for her that night. I made the kind of dinner that my mother wanted to have, and I served it to her. I put her at the head of the table. I gave her a chair with arms on it. On my next trip, while I was away, my mother died quietly in her sleep. Just the way she wanted to go, phlegmatic, peaceful, no problems, just went to sleep and never woke up. At the funeral, my brothers and I gave eulogies about my mother, and I shared with her friends back in Massachusetts how I was so sorry that it took me until the last month of my mother's life to know what her emotional needs were. And I shared with them that my mother has now gone to be with the Lord, and I know she's sitting at the right hand of Jesus, and I know he's given her a chair at the head of the table, and I'm sure it's got arms on it. When you leave today, think about that. Is there someone at your house who's waiting just to be put at the head of the table and to be given a chair with arms on it?